We're really very delighted here at the store to be hosting John Judis, who's going to talk about his recent book, The Populist Explosion. It's a book that came out about a month before last November's election, and very soon found itself on many lists of suggested works for people trying to understand the political transformation in America that was evidenced by the presidential campaign. John is a veteran journalist, of course, and has been observing and writing about American politics as well as international affairs for quite some time. For a number of years, he wrote for and helped edit the New Republic, and he's now editor-at-large of Talking Points Memo, a political journalism website. He's also the author of six other books on subjects ranging from the American Democratic Party to the origin of the Arab-Israeli conflict. In The Populist Explosion, John examines the resurgence of populism, both on the right and the left, in this country, with the rise not only of Donald Trump's candidacy, but also the strong showing by Bernie Sanders. He also looks at Europe and the growing success there of populist campaigns and rebellious parties. Answering not only the question of why now, John also addresses the promises and perils of these movements. A New York Times reviewer called the book a, quote, cogent and exceptionally clarifying guide to a political phenomenon that is at once elusive and, yes, explosive. And The Economist described the book as, quote, an excellent read, well-written and well-researched, powerfully argued, and perfectly timed. It's always nice when that happens. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming John Judis.
You want me to talk up here, right?
Yeah, and into the microphone.
Okay. Thank you. Nice to be here. This is, I've done seven books, and I've done six of them here. A little louder, okay. Can we turn the mic up so I don't? Okay. So I've done six, and the only one I didn't do here was Grand Illusion, 1992, and I did that at Common Concerns, and two people showed up, my sister-in-law and Martin Worcester, who's sitting back there, who's a loyal reader. So I'm really happy to see such a crowd tonight. I started this book, I think I signed the contract for it in May of 2015. And I had to talk the head of Columbia Global Reports, Nick Lemon, into letting me include the United States in the book. I said, well, you know, I actually know something about the United States. I don't know much about Europe. And okay, if you want, but there's not much going on. So, fast forward to August of 2015. My wife and I go to New Hampshire every summer. And so it was election time, so I was dragging her to all the Rand Paul with Hillary Clinton, so we should go see Donald Trump. And he was, I think he was in Hampton, and we arrived about a half hour early. And it was like, it was like they were giving free tickets away to Hamilton. Or there was a line like stretching from this high school out, 200 yards of people. And it was amazing. I couldn't believe what was going on there. And then Trump's speech itself, some of the same themes that are familiar now, the legal immigrants, a bad Iran deal. But he kept harping on these economic themes, Oreo in Chicago, the Oreos. Nabisco Company was moving to its plant to Mexico. And he said, well, I'm not going to eat Oreos anymore. He talked about corporations moving their headquarters overseas in order to avoid tax. And I was listening to him, and this combination again of the immigrants on the one hand and the economic nationalism. It was Ross Perot, it was Pat Buchanan. It was something I'd heard before, but that you don't hear at all from Republicans in the last 10, 15, 20 years. He used to say about Trump, he's not a normal Republican. Well, that's absolutely true. He's not. He's very unusual. So from that moment on, and you know, Bernie Sanders, of course, was having the same kind. You'd have the same kind of experiences going to his rallies. I knew I had a story on my hands, and that there was indeed a populist explosion going on, not only in Europe but in the United States. Now, when I give this talk, you're getting a new stump speech tonight because before the election, I did one thing, and then since then, I've been doing these conversations. These people like to do these things where people ask you questions. So, but I'm going to talk more tonight about the present than I usually do. But look, to begin, let me talk about populism itself and why I think it's a meaningful term with which to describe what's going on in the United States and Europe. Talking loudly is going to, I'm going to have a lot of water here. There is no definition of populism. It's like liberalism. You know, liberals in Australia are completely different from liberals in the United States. Sometimes populism is just used as a synonym for popular. Putin is sometimes called a populist. Ronald Reagan was a populist. I'm not talking about, again, an essence of populism. What I'm trying to describe in the book is a political tradition that begins in the United States in the 1880s and 1890s, migrates to Europe in the 1970s, and has become a major part of politics in both sides of the Atlantic. Now, what distinguishes that kind of populism is that the it's a mode of campaigning. It's not necessarily a mode of governing. And what distinguishes it is a distinction between the people and the elite. It's based upon the idea that there's a conflict between a group, and the group can change. It can be the poor, it can be the middle class, it can be the silent majority, it can be the crippled middle class, and an elite. The elite can be Washington, it can be the billionaire class, Bernie Sanders. But the basic idea is that there is this two-sided conflict. It's different from liberalism. Liberalism, progressivism, is based on the idea of a reconciling interests with a view towards the importance of poor people, the middle class, but still the idea of reconciliation in the end, pluralism. Business conservatism sees the world again from the idea that the best, that America, the interest of business is the interest of everybody else. It's holistic in that sense. Populism isn't. It's based on a conflict. Now, let me make a distinction between two kinds of populism and then take it away. I don't mean to confuse you, but I have a motive for doing it this way. With somebody like Bernie Sanders, or let's say Huey Long in the 1930s, or Podemos, the party in Spain, what you basically get is an attempt to unite the middle and the bottom of society against the top. That's populism. They're just two sides to it. And the issues are based on that. We want Medicare for all, public education for everybody, free. With more right-wing populists, let's say Marine Le Pen in France, Trump here, you get a third term enters the picture. And the third term can be African Americans, it could be Muslims, it can be illegal immigrants. And the idea is that the elite or establishment is coddling this group at the expense of the crippled middle class, the silent majority, or the people. Now, that's a way to see the difference between left and right, but let me say something to confuse the matter a little. If you look at, let's say, the National Front in France and its platform, you'll be surprised to see that it's in many respects to the left of the Democratic Party in the United States on domestic issues. 35-hour work week. They don't want to do away with Social Security or privatize it. They want people to be able to retire at a younger age. Industrial policy. They want government to be able to direct what corporations do and to prevent them from taking jobs overseas. So it's, in many ways, it's left-wing. It's a strange kind of melange. Trump himself, again, I talked about Oreos and Nabisco, Ford, Carrier, preventing companies from running from they're called runaway shops, taking jobs to Mexico or overseas and depriving workers here of their jobs. Trump and his campaign, we'll have to see what happens as president, a promise to protect Social Security and Medicare, again, in contrast to the people that he was running against. Bad trade deals. Very similar. He would say very similar things to what Bernie Sanders would say about NAFTA, for instance. So what I'm saying is you do get this distinction between different kinds of populism, but the result itself in both cases is a kind of politics which we don't ordinarily see around, and that you can't say, well, this is clearly left, or this is clearly right, or this clearly represents the Republicans, or this clearly represents the Democrats. What you're getting, and what, again, I think distinguishes the kind of populism I'm talking about, is an upsurge that represents a popular dissatisfaction with a prevailing consensus that has united the leadership in, let's say, in the United States, in both parties, in Europe, the Christian Democrats and the Social Democrats, Labor and the Tories. You're getting a kind of what I would call an early warning signal that this consensus itself is starting to break up. Now, how does this work in the United States? The first big populist party, the People's Party, 1890s, was a protest against laissez-faire capitalism. And it was obviously an early warning signal. And really, the kinds of things the populists campaign for only start to get put into effect with Theodore Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson, and then to a great extent with Franklin Roosevelt. So it's an early warning signal that this system isn't working. Now let's move up to the present in the last 40 or 50 years. What's going on now? What is the prevailing consensus? From, let's say, 1935 through mid to the late 1970s, the prevailing consensus in the United States was something like New Deal liberalism. In Europe, it was something like social democracy, even if those weren't the parties in charge, even if it were Christian Democrats or Republicans in charge. And the underlying idea was, you could say it was demand-driven. If people get higher wages, then there'll be greater profits. If there are greater profits, those can finance government benefits, and in turn, higher wages, and from that, you'll get greater profits. So it was a kind of virtuous circle that began with the assumption that as Americans become more prosperous, business will become more prosperous, and so on. 1970s big global economic crisis, beginning of heightened competition, Europe and Japan recover from World War II. Unions are very powerful, threatening profits from below. And you get stagflation, inflation, unemployment at the same time. And what happens is that the consensus itself erodes, and you get the beginning of a new kind of worldview, a new kind of idea of how the economy should be run. And that idea is almost the reverse. I mean, in the United States, you talk about supply-side economics. In Europe, you talk about neoliberalism. Sometimes I use the term market liberalism. And the basic idea is just the opposite, which is that if you do things to make corporations more profitable, then that will lead to increased wages, and that in turn will help government provide benefits. But the key thing and the key beginning, again, is corporate profits and rates of profit. So what kind of things follow from that? First of all, corporate mobility. Corporations should be able to move wherever they want, multinational corporations, in search of situations where their costs are less, where they have to deal with less regulation. Again, a lot of the free trade treaties, NAFTA, things like that, if you look at the actual treaties, about two-thirds of them are devoted to making sure that if an American corporation moves to Mexico, it won't be nationalized. So corporate mobility, labor mobility. Now, in the United States, our immigration laws are revised initially for the sake of civil rights, not for the sake of business. But because of particular provisions in them, family reunification in particular, they lead to this enormous influx of unskilled labor, particularly from the South, from south of the border, which again gets increased still more in 1990 when there's another immigration law is passed. And again, the effect of that is to put pressure, downward pressure on wages, make all kinds of construction, restaurants, hotels, things like that, more viable. So labor mobility, capital mobility, if you think about it, you find the same thing in Europe, and especially you're thinking about in terms of immigration. Deregulation, finance, again, making costs less, making it more possible to have profits, and tax reform with an idea, again, of lowering taxes on corporations and banks. So that's the prevailing view. Now, you know, Ronald Reagan used to talk about a rising tide will lift all boats, and as long as the boats seem to be going up, as they did after the big recession in 1982, you know, everybody was happy with it. But what you get in 1991 is the first recession, and it's a really peculiar recession that seems to drag on. And what happens then? Perot and Buchanan. That's when you get the first upsurge. That's when you get the first big challenge to this neoliberal consensus. 1996, 97, the internet boom, the post-industrial boom in the United States. Buchanan and Perot virtually disappear. War on terror, preoccupation with a threat from abroad. Then you get the Great Recession. And in the wake of the Great Recession, we've had a wave of these movements and candidates, Tea Party, Occupy Wall Street, and finally Sanders and Trump. And if you look again at both those campaigns and what they have in common, they are beyond all the Trump's, again, incendiary craziness and stuff like that. There's a basic challenge to this neoliberal consensus that characterizes both campaigns, the rigged economy. You even get the same language. So, again, that's what you get. That's when you get populist movements in America. Now, why? This is a question that I ask myself and that nobody asked me, but it bothers me. Why should we still have this kind of upsurge in America, given that there's been a recovery, as you know, as Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama both reminded people during the 2016 campaign? I mean, aren't things fine? Isn't America great? What you know? Why do we have to make it great again? And I don't really have all the answers to that question, but I came across a few things that I think are important. First, of course, is that the shape of American industry has changed. We lost, 5 million manufacturing jobs between 2000 and 2015, and those were not necessarily replaced by better jobs, some cases worse jobs. And if you look at a map of where those jobs were lost and where Trump scored his surprising victories, there's an incredible match. What do you think was the state that had the second biggest loss of manufacturing jobs? Number one was Michigan. What was number two?
Ohio.
North Carolina.
Number
a state that Trump won, furniture. So again, there's this incredible kind of match. Now, the second thing that happened, I discovered this study that Alan Krueger, who was the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisers under Obama, we're not talking about any kind of maverick right-wing economist, and Lawrence Katz did recently about where jobs had come from in the last 10 years. And their conclusion just amazed me, but it does really explain a lot of what's going on, both for Trump and Sanders. A striking implication, and I'm reading from them, of these estimates is that all of the net employment growth in the U.S. economy from 2005 to 2015 appears to have occurred in alternative work arrangements. You know what that is? Temp work, part-time, and contract work. Those are not people who have full-time, W-2 jobs with people. It breeds insecurity. I think, again, if you look at the Sanders electorate, a lot of college educated, but not like the new left of the 60s, which was more, I was at Berkeley, so it was more on the upper tier of colleges. You know, you go to George Mason to hear Sanders, and the place was completely packed. It's people who face a lot of uncertainty in their lives and don't see a kind of easy path forward. So I think that even, again, though we've had this kind of recovery, and you can see it in employment numbers, 4.8% or something now, the basic problem of economics insecurity has not been solved at all. And there's an underlying pessimism that fed both the Trump and the Sanders campaign. The additional thing that you have to mention for Trump is Islamic terrorism plus immigration. And that's also incredibly important for Europe. That creates a kind of fusion. And so you get both that, and you get the economic insecurity, and you get boom, this amazing results where this guy won the election, contrary to anything that I expected would happen. So let me now have a drink here, and you can think about it. I want to talk a little now about Trump. Let me see what I want to say, and I won't take too long. If you look at Trump's past, people say about him, well, this guy, he's a total opportunist. He just has his ideas that he wanted to be president, and he cooked up a campaign and stuff. I don't think that that's the right way to look at him. There's a few elements of Trump, and some of them help explain why he's been successful. The economic nationalism goes back, as far as I could tell, 20, 30 years. The concern about trade. I think that Trump's basic experience is the same as I had. I'm of the same generation, basically, as Trump. And that is, when we grew up, we would go into a store. Bookstore doesn't count, but let's say it was an electronic store. We didn't have, we didn't have Best Buy then, but whatever the equivalent was, you would look for something that was made in America. And it wasn't because you were patriotic at all. It was because everything else was going to be junk. A Japanese thing, that was going to be a crappy knockoff. And it was an incredibly jarring experience for this generation in the 1970s and 1980s to start going into, let's say, buying a television, and for there not being a single American television. Zenith was the last one. When it left Illinois, it was all over. Cars, you name it. When Trump, again, talks about Make America Great Again, that's part of the idea that's swirling around in the back, and that's also swirling around in the back of the heads of his electorate. The same thing, too, about the military and America's success. We were brought up, Memorial Day, May just used to be enormous parades. I used to go and, you know, sit there, line the sidewalk in Chicago. It was a big deal. The military was heroic. Now, a lot of us lost that sense in the Vietnam War, but I don't think Trump did. And I think, again, that's important to his idea of what it means to make America great. And I think it resonated among a lot of the older voters that he appealed to. Because, again, if you look at his electorate, it trended older. Trump was also, you know, you must know this, was a kind of moderate Democrat. He was always registered as a Democrat. He was came out for single-payer health insurance. He was pro-choice. You know, all the things you would, he sort of like Ed Koch, you know, in New York, something like that, or Alphonse D'Amato, who was a Republican, but again, was now would be in the far left of the Republican Party. So that was another dimension of Trump. Now, as he began to run for office, my sense of him is that he began to pick up issues that he thought would particularly appeal to the Republican base. The birther stuff starts in 2011, that Obama really wasn't born here. He drops that during the campaign because it's too incendiary. But illegal immigration, now when he was going to run for Reform Party presidential nominee in 1999, he said he agreed with Pat Buchanan on illegal immigration, but he didn't go, I mean, he didn't demonize illegal immigrants the way he did in the campaign, Mexican rapists and all that stuff. That really starts, that's really something I think that's integral to his campaign and to the way he campaigned. So, you know, again, what you get with Trump is this combination of nationalism and these kind of issues that he's picked up by which to appeal to the Republican base. Obamacare. I think if he was running, you know, in a different era or something, he wouldn't give a damn about Obamacare. That's, again, Obamacare is a disaster, was a key issue. He had to do that for the Republican base. The question's going to be, you know, to what extent does he give in to classic Republicanism, and to what extent, again, this is what surprised me, and I'll talk about this in a second, is has he been willing to gear his politics itself to this base that he has, but not to the whole of the American people? And I'm thinking particularly, again, of the way he's dealt with illegal immigration since he became president. But let me talk for a minute about Trump's base, because I think that's important to understand. There's a sociologist by the name of Donald Warren who wrote a book in 1976 based on studies that he made in 1971 and 1976. And Warren picked out a part of the electorate. They were the voters, they were the heart of George Wallace's vote in 1968 and 1972. And as I describe them, you'll see the similarities. They were older rather than younger. And we're not talking about, you know, 90% of the people were over 70, but, you know, they tended to be older rather than young, tended to be more male, tended to be even more strongly white, had a high school education and no more. Now we wouldn't say that. Now we would say they'd gone to some college, or they'd gone to a modest, they graduated from a modest college, but not a really fancy one. And what Warren found about this group was that, first of all, they were not classically right-wing. They liked Medicare, for instance. They liked Social Security. They didn't like the fact that the rich got away without paying taxes. But at the same time, they felt that the elites, the establishment, the people in power were making them sacrifice in order to aid this third group. In this case, with George Wallace, it was African Americans. So they felt besieged in the middle, besieged from above and below. Now, this group of voters goes through the electorate over the last 50 years, sort of the way a large animal would go through a python, you know, where you see the animal doesn't actually get swallowed. In the late 1970s, it's the anti-tax movement. In the 80s, it's the Christian Coalition and the Moral Majority. Perot Buchanan, especially Buchanan's constituency. Then the War on Terror. And in what characterizes this group is that there's a whole multi-dimension. They have cultural concerns, social concerns, economic concerns. When I used to go to Christian Coalition meetings in the early 90s, because I covered them as a reporter, I would interview people about NAFTA, for instance. And the heads of the Christian Coalition were business types, Ralph Reed and Pat Robertson, son of a senator, who went along with the Republican Party, whatever it was doing on economic stuff. But if you talk to the base, they were all Buchananites. They all were very much against NAFTA. So you get this kind of mix of economic nationalism, you could say nativism in terms of culture, concern about illegal immigration, and it runs through the electorate from the early 1970s to now. What distinguishes the present and what distinguishes Trump's electorate is the predominance again of these economic concerns in the wake of the Great Recession. That and the fusion of illegal immigrants and radical Islam, and you really have the sort of the formula for why Trump is now the president of the United States. Now, let me talk a little to conclude about his presidency. Again, if you look at his appointments, they're drawn from all different parts. Now, the economic nationalist part of it is Navarro, he's a special counsel for trade. He's in the White House. He's the trade guy. Leitziker, who's the other trade guy. These are all people, again, who a lot of labor Democrats would agree with, especially if you get them to talk off the record. There's no, they're tough on China. They don't like runaway shops. Wilbur Ross, Secretary of Commerce, again, very much in that category. Then you get the people who are more, again, either sops to the Republican leadership in Congress, or expressions, again, of Trump's own more extreme views that he voiced on, let's say, immigration. So you get Sessions, you get DeVos, and you get people like Price at Health and Human Services, who's mission in life has been to dismantle Obamacare and make doctors rich. So, a real nightmare, even from the standpoint, if he got his way, of a lot of Trump's constituency. Now, I always have an optimistic view of these things. When the Monica Lewinsky scandal hit, and it was sometime in January of 1998, I thought it would blow over, if you pardon the expression, in a week or two. And when Trump became president, I thought, well, this guy, he's run this whole scam as a candidate and stuff, and all this, crooked Hillary and stuff. But he'll realize that he has to be president of all the people. And you act differently. The institution itself will shape the man. And, could happen. another 6 months of this crazy stuff, and maybe he'll come around. But what surprised me is the extent to which he's tried to retain his own populism. Populism is really a style of politics. It's not a style of governing. You have to go to, let's say, Chavez in Venezuela to find an analogy where somebody comes into office and tries to continue the basic conflict that's got him there in the first place. But lo and behold, Trump has done it. And if you heard the press conference today, it's the people versus the coastal elites and the media. Inaugural address, it's Washington. So he's maintained that. And what he's done in terms of the Muslim ban and blaming illegal immigrants for Hillary's popular margin seems to reflect on his part the idea that he's not the president of all the people, but that he's mainly talking to his base. And that's the people I was describing, the radical center. That's maybe, between 20 and 30% of the electorate. I would guess that the rest of his what got Trump over the top was that, plus people, you know, conventional Republicans who wouldn't vote for a Democrat, and independents who really didn't like Hillary. But the core, the hardcore embattled populist constituency, you know, maybe 20, 25, 30%. But that's the people that he's speaking to as president. And it surprised me. And, you know, his blaming 5 million illegal immigrants for Hillary's margin, I found shocking. That's classic scapegoating. So I thought the guy would take a more mature attitude, but indeed he hasn't at all. And it surprised me and it worries me. And I'm particularly worried about a situation where we will inevitably have terrorist attacks in the United States again. I mean, I'd be amazed if we can get through the next 4 years without. What's going to happen next? I mean, what's the response going to be given what he's already done and said in terms of how far he was willing to go with the Muslim ban, green card people? Are we in a kind of vicious circle where we get a kind of assault upon democracy? Now, just to conclude, one of the things that concerns me, though, about my own side of the political spectrum, the left and the Democrats and whatever, is that that we get caught in a kind of situation where whatever Trump says has to be wrong, and whatever he proposes has to be wrong, and that we don't look at the core problems that in a very imperfect, bigoted, or whatever way he was appealing to and that he discovered, the Oreo cookies of Nabisco, again, companies moving overseas to avoid taxes. Now, in his first press conference after he was elected, so this was before the inauguration in January, if you remember, he attacked drug companies for their pricing. It was shocking, but again, it was not something you'd hear from a Republican. So again, it was also something, you know, Bernie Sanders. But then I read Larry Summers, you know, former Obama person in the Washington Post, and threatening businesses, as happened with the attack on the pharmaceutical industry during Trump's last news conference, risks major increases in uncertainty and even questions about the rule of law. So I guess to conclude, what concerns me again is that we understand that we are in a basic crisis about neoliberalism, and that we really do have to find a way out of it and different policies than the ones we followed in the past. Now, in immediate terms, the Democrats and the left are going to prosper if Trump and the Republicans start to attack the kind of core programs that everybody supports, Social Security, Medicare. If they start doing that stuff, if they completely dismantle Obamacare. And, you know, in that sense, the Democrats, and their best offense is a good defense in that case. And I think that's, you know, again, I think they could ride that success. But in the medium term and long term, I think we have to think about what our positions are on trade, on corporations being able to move where they are, on a huge influx of unskilled immigrants, and what that does, among other things, to African Americans in the United States, many of whom are competing for those jobs. So that's my pitch, and I welcome any questions you have. And you have to speak clearly, because sometimes, you know, I have trouble with it.
Okay, so I'm over here.
Ah, there you are.
So my question follows exactly what you just said. You and I are of an age, and I remember all of these things happening. I grew up in what was then called the People's Republic of Massachusetts and went to public school, and we learned about Keynesianism. That's demand side, the virtuous circle. And my question is, do you still believe it? I do. I mean, I think it isn't that the good jobs went away. It's that there's nothing special about manufacturing. What was special about manufacturing jobs that made them good was that they were union jobs. And you could make hospital workers union workers and pay them accordingly. And that what we have to do is not get the good jobs back, but make the current jobs good jobs. Do you think that will still drive the economy? And of course, we have to put back in taxes on the people who can afford to pay them.
Okay.
And finance it that way.
That's a good question, and that's happens to be something I've thought about too. One of the things Trump talks about is bringing back manufacturing jobs,
right.
And the response is always, that just means robots. I think that's wrong. You can look at the estimates done by the Economic Policy Institute or this what ITIF. What does that stand for? The Institute of Technology, Rob Atkinson's group.
Mm-hmm.
It's about, again, it's not 90% robots. The job, the biggest loss of jobs in manufacturing comes between 2000 and 2015, and it happens to coincide with when we let China have its preferred
right.
trading status
right.
and then
right.
go into the WTO,
right.
and all kinds of currency manipulation and subsidies existed, and that really decimated American manufacturing. So, again, I think that it's a legitimate issue, and it's legitimate in another way, that manufacturing is value added. Even if we have robots, it's fine, but the large profits can be used to finance a welfare state.
Exactly.
So, also, manufacturing has better multiplier than service industries.
Right.
It creates more other jobs outside than, say, setting up a home care facility does. So I think that that's another issue where Democrats can be misled into opposing what Trump says just because he says it, but that it's a real issue. The other thing I'd say is that what we have to be concerned with, and I think this was really important to Sanders too, was trying to eliminate this level of economic anxiety that people feel. And that's partly a question of jobs, but it's also a question of social programs. A better program
right.
than the Affordable Care Act, where you don't have to be have a degree in public administration to figure
Medicare
it all
for
out.
All.
Again, protecting Social Security, all these kinds of things to establish a kind of level of security that a lot of Europeans and Canadians feel, but that Americans don't feel, and instead it sort of feeds unconsciously into this kind of politics that we have. So that's the...
Thank you.
You know, I have a friend who's a lawyer and was a union president, and he loves Trump. He's very anti-quota legal immigration, etc., and seems very anti-left, anti-liberal, and he's my only right-wing friend. And I said to him, what about Bernie? He said, oh, he's a good man. I'd go for him, too. And I thought it's amazing that both Trump and Bernie would attract the same person. So what makes if a populist is against the ruling elite or whatever from the people, what makes a right-wing populist versus a left-wing populist?
Well, I think I explained that, but I also know people who had the same, who would say this exactly the same thing, and it always surprised me that the two candidates they liked were Trump and Sanders. And there was an element of authenticity, and there was an element of anti-Washington and feeling that these people were willing to rock the boat and that Hillary and Jeb Bush were just part of the problem. Again, what made Trump more right-wing, I think, was his attitude towards illegal immigration, not illegal immigration. I'm not one of these people who won't use the word illegal immigration. That's, that's going on. It's against it's against the law. You don't have to use euphemisms for it. We have to do something about the people who are already here, right? Can't deport them. But I think the ability that he scapegoated. And that's really what pushes him into the right-wing camp. The Finns, not to get into this, there's a party, the True Finns, who have a more reasonable, I mean, they're sort of centrist populace, and they want a Canadian system in Finland of immigration. But, you know, again, you don't have to have that kind of scapegoating, but that's exactly what Trump has done in terms of immigration. And that's a difference between him and Sanders.
I guess what I meant was what attracts a person to Trump or attracts a person to Sanders.
I tried to deal with that.
Why does one go right and one voter goes left?
Well, again, you know, this was not I don't think it's a really common phenomenon. I don't think you'd have the same block of voters. I just knew, I happened to anecdotally know people who went from one to the other. But again, what attracts them is the populism. People versus the establishment, the elite. That was basic to both their campaigns.
Thank you.
Over there.
So I'm picking up on that. I think it was Ralph Nader that was here, and he spoke about these 25 fundamental issues on which both conservatives and liberals agree. Conservatives and liberals agree with one another. And he pointed to the outliers as this kind of entrenched establishment that was the problem. And amidst all this noise and controversy over Trump, often overlooked is this deep division within the Democratic Party. I mean, you have the neoliberal wing, Hillary Clinton, and these narratives such as this kind of Soviet saber-rattling, anti-Soviet saber-rattling, and then you've got, you know, the Bernie people. And these don't seem reconcilable.
Oh, and
ask any millennial.
We'll see. There's nothing like having somebody like Donald Trump in office to reconcile feuding parts of the opposing party. So I think part of the argument is going to go towards Bernie and Elizabeth Warren for the time being. But again, I think that the Democrats are not going to unite on Medicare for All. That's not a winning issue. I think what they're going to unite on is protecting the existing framework of social services in America, you know, again, defending immigrants against really outrageous stuff and things like that. They're not going to unite at this point around an advanced social democratic program.
But doesn't it also raise questions about whether the two-party structure is viable anymore and whether there's an open door?
Well, that's all we have.
All kinds of alternatives.
It's not been viable for 150 years. I mean, unless you can't, you know, we have this kind of electoral system where third parties are spoilers. So they flicker and disappear. I don't expect that to happen.
This seems to have legs, though.
Okay. Next.
Part of your book reminded me when Franklin Roosevelt had his fireside chats, that kind of idea that the personal qualities of a candidate can often be very influential. And in one place in your book, on page 63, you comment, Trump had the rare skill of saying virtually the same thing to one audience after another, but appearing each time to be having a conversation with his audience. You know, your discussion now has shifted toward the end here to a lot of policy stuff. And one of the problems with Obama and Hillary Clinton, they both have, they say a lot about policy, but it's a rather wooden presentation. I thought that was one of the most revealing comments you made in the entire book. You don't go into detail about it, but right. That idea that, you know, Trump's style seems odd and everything else, but he does have the ability to communicate to his audience.
Right. Well, that was a great strength. I thought of it in my mind as, you remember these French novels you used to be able to shuffle and they'd come out, it wouldn't matter what place you started with. Trump's speeches were like that. Sometimes he would change the order, but he would almost always say the same thing. But he would just seem to be talking to you for the first time. The other thing about Trump and versus Hillary, and I think this applies to Bernie also, is that Trump was a thematic politician. Make America great again. he framed his appeal in terms of themes, not in terms of lists of programs. Hillary Clinton was more a list candidate. I haven't thought of a better word for it. The Democrats seemed to be afflicted by those in the past. Obama wasn't. Obama, Bernie were both thematic candidates. Gore, Kerry, you know, again, lists of programs, but not an underlying theme that captures people's imagination. And Trump had that, to his credit. Bernie had it also. So, yeah, that was a big, big difference. Yes.
Hi, I have two questions. One,
I better write these down. Too.
So that group that's been traveling through the Python, as you put it, and kind of have ended up being a big piece of the electorate that voted for Trump. I was wondering, like, your view on how they perceive his actions now and how kind of Republicans in general, like, I know a lot of liberals are appalled, but is there another swath of the country that is, yes, we finally have what we want in office? So that's one question. And the second one is, you had just said how Democrats are kind of missing a part of the conversation around what's really what's the real problem, what's really afflicting certain segments of the population, like trade and whatnot, and manufacturing. How do you think we can get that into the conversation? Because it's an important part of it, that if we miss, we kind of are, we're off kilter.
Let's see. Now, how does Trump electorate perceive him? Well, you know, again, I don't know. I've been sitting at home with my cat, so I really I haven't been out of the house virtually for 2 months. So, I could just go on just tell you what the polls say, which you probably already know, which is that he retains a lot of support. And a lot of support among the people who voted for him in the first place. And, you know, they don't necessarily see the ruckus that he's making in Washington as a bad thing. They might see it as a good thing. He's shaking things up. He's making people upset. You know, if you watch the press conference today, there was on the one hand, he was acting like a nut, and it was very ludicrous and petty, all this stuff about, you know, going back over Hillary Clinton and the election, his baiting of the press. But on the other hand, it was entertaining. And he was really giving the press, you know, what he thought they deserved. He was being, you know, a tough guy. He wasn't wilting under the pressure. So I think, again, that's another way to see him. I don't think he's by any means finished yet. And what you have to watch for is the same thing you watched for with Nixon, Republican leadership, what happens. Not McCain and Lindsey Graham, who were outliers to begin with, but if the Republican leadership, if Corker and people like that start distancing themselves significantly from Trump, then you're going to see a real problem, because he won't be able to do anything in Congress, and you might even get investigations and stuff like that. Mm. Democrats, I talked about that a little. You know, the way parties work is if you're an intellectual and you write for journals and stuff, you can start thinking now about what they should say in 2020, but it's going to be primarily defensive for the next 2 years.
How big of a danger do you see of authoritarianism rising out of this new populism, both here and in Europe, and is there something to be concerned about our democratic institutions and a weakening of democracy?
Right. Look, I don't believe we're in a similar period to the 1920s and 1930s. The populist parties of Europe and the United States have operated within a democratic framework. They don't have internal agendas where they want to get rid of the communists and socialists, whatever. Well, but I would still see a danger, and I think I described it a little in the talk, that Trump has staked so much on ISIS and terror and immigration and issues like that, that if we get into a situation where there are terrorist attacks, that might become the pretext for cutting down on democratic rights. In other words, you can imagine what would happen. The terrorist attacks, he goes overboard, overreacts. There's big demonstrations against him. The press goes out after him. He says, well, we can't have the press maligning the president this way. That would be the scenario that I would see that would lead down a very very dark alley for the United States.
And in Europe?
I don't, presently, no. I don't think Marine Le Pen is going to win. I don't think, of course, you know, I didn't think Trump was going to win either. But they have a two, you know, they have this system where you have two elections. You have a runoff between the two at the end. And so what usually happens is that all the different parties from the left and center, if it's a center-right candidate, back that candidate against Marine Le Pen. And I think in Europe, Trump is going to scare a lot of centrist voters or center-right voters who might have entertained the thought of Marine Le Pen or even, you know, alternative for Deutschland. So I think in an odd way, he is going to lead toward worse days for the populist right in Europe.
I'm here as someone who voted for Bernie in our primary and would never have imagined voting for Trump.
Speak closer to the mic.
You voted for
Bernie in the primary.
Yeah, so what I'm interested in is you trace the Trump voters back to the late 60s, early 70s, going through the Python and ending up right. In 2016 voting for Trump. What about the people who voted for Bernie?
Right, that's a good question.
And what was, you know, what are their roots? And yes, there's the overlap, perhaps, of right. people who could have voted for either and ended up voting for him, Trump. But a lot of the Bernie people would not have imagined voting for Trump. Who were they? What's that populism?
Yeah, that's right. I deal with this a little in the book, but I'm waiting for the big surveys to come out to really figure out what it was all about. But I think a lot of Bernie's voters were young, in college or college educated. That was really the heart of his constituency. If you talk about Trump trending older, he trended younger. I would go to the rallies and you'd see people like you or me, and then there would be this enormous gap, you know, mm-hmm. in the middle. It would mm-hmm. be the grandparents and the children, yeah. right?
Yeah.
And what you get is, with us, is the remnants of the Nader generation. I'm talking about not Ralph from 2000, but the new left, the 60s, mm-hmm. environmentalism, all that stuff. People who were just deeply offended by the way the financial industry got off the hook in 2008. And, you know, again, yeah. saw yeah. Bernie as a clarion. But I think some of the young voters are more significant for the future. And again, I think, you know, there's an economic dimension, student debt. But I also think that there's a way in which, again, it's similar to the late 50s and early 60s in some way, that they felt that they no longer have a place to go within American capitalism. There's no longer, the economy has been mm-hmm. divided into all these little niches of specialization. And there isn't a sense of security. And I'm not talking about kids who might go to medical school, though even, God knows, doctors themselves feel besieged these days in some way. But again, the George Masons, what surprised me again was he got support from a different level of college students and the young than we saw in the, let's say, in 1968 or something like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I was in Nevada he had a rally at a junior college there. And the place was just packed. And mm-hmm. it was kids of fairly modest background. And again, the combination of the student debt, the uncertainty about the future, and, you know, the same thing that we felt about the Great Recession and its cause. is bringing them to the fore. I don't think that this is necessarily a constituency that you can join with the Trump voters into a grand coalition that'll take over the country. No. But it is there, and it's a in, you know, when I went to Spain in Madrid and went to the Podemos meeting. Podemos is the party, populist mm-hmm. party in Spain. I looked at the people at this conference and I said, oh my God, you know, this looks like if SDS hadn't gone crazy and people had stuck around for about 7 years into 1976 and they were like, you know, in their early 30s, this would be what this crowd would look like, college mm-hmm. educated, you know, hippie types and stuff mm-hmm. like that. And in Spain, of course, there's like 40% unemployment among the young and stuff. But that's related to the Bernie thing. They're the cousins overseas of the Bernie voters. Just that the Brexit voters are related to Trump. So that's the.
Yeah, and I'm hoping that those Bernie voters are right at the core of resistance right now.
Uh huh. Thank you.